Cuba, to this day, remains a name many people rightly associate with the Cold War. It was undoubtedly a point of concern for the United States that a communist, Soviet-aligned state insisted on merely existing just 90 miles off the coast of Florida. But the communist revolution in Cuba also came as a shock, because before the revolution itself, Cuba was close to the United States both economically and culturally. But not all was as rosy on the island as portrayed by I Love Lucy. Cuba was a colony in all but name, with economic exploitation, rampant crime, and substantial economic and social inequality. I'm your host David, and today we're going to look under the hood at Cuba on the eve of revolution, and what factors in this society really pushed its people to overthrow their capitalist rulers. This is the Cold War. Today, most Americans can't go to Cuba because of a travel embargo put in place after the revolution. However, for most everyone else, it's still a popular tourist destination, especially for people like myself here in Canada. Touring the island, you see a lot of relics of Cuba's complicated history of being a subject of Washington. On the eve of the revolution, Cuba was thoroughly under the thumb of the US. Before the late 19th century, Cuba was a Spanish colony, but beginning in 1868, Cubans began a revolt against their European rulers. Over 10 years, this struggle gained the Cubans much sympathy and support from the Americans, who clandestinely smuggled people and weapons into the island despite official US neutrality. In spite of this, the Spanish did win the war, but they conceded to the Cubans a greater degree of economic and political independence than they had before. With this more liberalized economy, the US built a love affair with the Cuban people. They were happy to buy almost the entirety of Cuba's exports. Relations also improved as rich and famous Americans began to buy vacation homes on the island. After the revolt, Cuba's economy was in dire straits, and American investors poured money into the island, buying up businesses, industries, and properties at rock-bottom prices. What this resulted in was an island that, while a colony of Spain, was heavily integrated into the American economy. Americans now owned many businesses and homes in Cuba, and Cuban exports went almost entirely to the US. The Spanish had won, but their hold on Cuba was slipping. Soon, seeing both the economic and also the strategic importance of Cuba, the US began long-term plans to annex the island. After rising tensions in Cuba spilled over into the Second War of Independence in 1897, the US offered to buy Cuba from the Spanish, but the offer was refused. The rejection, coupled with a very convenient, albeit accidental, explosion of the USS Maine, prompted Washington to declare war on Spain, a little conflagration known as the Spanish-American War. The war was a short and decisive victory for the US, and Cuba received its independence in the Treaty of Paris late the next year. This was fully realized in 1902 when the US military occupation ended, except of course for, Guantanamo Bay, which the US reserved for use as a naval base, and eventually extraterritorial prison. Despite Cuba being independent, the US often intervened in Cuban politics thanks to the Platt Amendment, using the military to launch multiple interventions and occupations before the revolution. The military and political domination of Cuba was strong, but running even deeper than that was the economic control, which grew even more profound. By 1926, 60% of Cuba's sugar production belonged to American companies, meaning profits left the country to line American pockets instead of further developing Cuba. 95% of sugar exports went to the US, making Cuba hopelessly dependent on American markets, and also afraid to anger them as a result. Any trade sanction would obliterate the Cuban economy. Real estate companies began to pop up, and American socialites and elites bought Cuban homes in droves. So all of this is a preamble to what Cuba was at the dawn of the revolution, America's playground. It was a sort of Las Vegas before Las Vegas was, well, Las Vegas. By the 1920s, the tourism boom spurred a rise in casinos, which really took off by the 1950s. The Batista government helped invest in the construction of luxurious hotels with casinos inside them. But who built these casinos and lined their pockets? Well, the funders of the gambling industry were a small contingent of Cuban elites, state banks, American union funds, and famously, the American mafia. Mafia owners would skim profits, cheat investors, and traffic large amounts of drugs to the island in order to make it the perfect den of sin. All part of a nice getaway, you know, if that's your thing. Now, this corruption all happened without regard for the Cuban people. Very few Cubans, and most of them white and wealthy, could afford to stay in these beautiful hotels, or gamble in those flashy casinos, or take those fun drugs. The only way the vast majority of Cubans were going to enter a casino was by wearing a uniform and, well, shuffling cards. So you can imagine what it would feel like to be a working class Cuban. You'd see these beautiful casinos, places of luxury set aside for foreign tourists. They were a living monument to American domination and the stark inequalities of the country. It's not surprising that these casinos were high up on the looting targets by future revolutionaries. Of course, despite the casinos, Cubans had many more important reasons to be angry with Batista's regime, specifically the torture and murder, but still, the casinos were a highly visible symbol of the excessive corruption of his government. So there's a common idea, though, that moral outrage against the casinos, criminals, and debauchery is what motivated people like Fidel Castro to overthrow the regime. However, a growing body of research seems to show that this is actually a massive exaggeration. The story of mafiosos and crooked casinos were sensationalized, and their role in Cuban society overrepresented. For example, the gambling industry, even at its peak, never broke 10% of the profits of their gargantuan sugar industry. The Cuban revolutionaries instead were angry about the dictatorship of the Batista regime. Public officials were wildly corrupt, the US was growing ever more imperialistic, and there was massive economic inequality. Rural poverty in Cuba was severe, and there was extreme unemployment, especially amongst young people. As anyone who has listened to a few seasons of Revolutions with Mike Duncan could tell you, this was a recipe for revolution. If you look at the kinds of issues people like Castro spoke out about, it was about the tyranny of landlords, the need for land reform for the peasant class, and democracy in the workplace. The revolutionaries wanted to nationalize industries like electricity and telephone lines into public services, since at the time they were owned by American companies. As well, Cuba had an entrenched racial caste system, which the revolutionaries opposed. White Cubans still held much of the power, while a subjugated black working class struggled to survive, often as landless peasants on massive agricultural plantations owned by American businesses. Now, Cuba was a one-crop economy. This fact meant that farmland for commodities needed for domestic consumption, you know, things like food, was sidelined to make sugar, a cash crop for American businesses. This situation drove up food prices and made the poor even poorer. Around 80% of farmable land belonged to large landowners who only cared about making sugar, and 25% of the country's best farmland belonged to US monopolies. Most Cubans couldn't afford to go to any school, and in rural areas, electricity and running water were rare. Half of rural Cubans, or about a quarter of the whole population, were illiterate. It was a period of severe economic struggle. All the while, you could see Batista and his corrupt government officials hobnobbing with wealthy American tourists in those luxurious casinos. The situation was almost a perfect case for a working people's revolution, and as we know, that's precisely what was about to occur. This video is far from our last about Cuba. The revolution itself and the reconstruction of Cuba after the revolution is a long and winding tale. Plus, I think there was a crisis involving missiles of some kind, which we actually might need to mention at some point. Cuban revolutionaries saw their country for what it was, a place where a few enjoyed lives of luxury, while at the same time, the vast majority of the population struggled to survive. Over and over again in history, this has been the fertile soil where revolutions are born. And as we all know, Cuba was no exception. Where Fidel Castro and his revolutionaries would take things, well, that's the topic for future videos. We hope you've enjoyed today's topic, and to make sure you don't miss future episodes, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel and have exploited the bell button. We can also be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at thecoldwartv. If you enjoy our work, please consider supporting us via www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. This is the Cold War Channel, and don't forget, the trouble with the Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it becomes heated.